Y'all love my church here? That's where we're here. Love to be here in the house of the Lord, Sunday night. Finish the weekend well. Start the next week well, because it's actually the first day of the week, yeah? Launch in for the next week right here tonight. Welcome. Move around. Greet as many people as you can. All around the place. Find someone you need to talk to tonight. Say hello to them. Make them feel encouraged tonight. In Jesus' name, we're going to do it. Fascinating expression found in Psalm 42, verse 7, and we sing it pretty well every Sunday, and it's kind of that, those words that kind of just roll off your lips, deep cries out to deep. And I looked around since it's taken my attention, just to see how you're doing with it, singing it, because I look around and see how you're facing up to singing. Is it just like singing Mary Had a Little Lamb, it's fleece was white as snow? And everywhere that Lamb went, there it was sure to go. Or do you think, wow, I know what this means and I'm really putting it out there. See, I think these songs that include this expression, we better have some idea what they mean. Otherwise you might as well be doing nursery rhymes. And so I've dug deeply in these last month or two looking at this, songs that have this expression, as well as looking at the writings of long-time exegetes and commentators, preachers of the past, and also I've looked at some more contemporary exegetes and preachers and writers on this subject. What I've found is it's a very contentious issue. You just sing it like, isn't it a great song to sing, and the words, deep calls out to deep. What a great poetic expression. You don't have a clue what it means, but it's just so easy to roll off your lips, isn't it? Deep cries out to deep. And it's a contentious issue because the current bloggers who like to be contentious about churches that are doing well like to pick fault with them. Churches aren't doing well, no one picks fault with them. If it's not doing well, and no one cares. When you start to do well, that's when the bloggers arc up under the name of Christianity. And they go, you know, these Bethel songwriters and these Hillsong writers, they use this expression, deep calls out to deep, and they use it in the wrong way. Well, it comes from Psalm 42, verse 7, as you can see on your screen there. And what I want to do tonight is send you home so that when you sing this at the end of this message tonight, the end of this service, and when you sing it again several times next week, you're going to go, I know what that means. This is a cry from my heart. I know what it means. Father in heaven, tonight, please give us insight into your word tonight. Give us news that we can use as we seek your face and seek to rise above any negative circumstances that we find get into our lives. Father, we call on you tonight in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. I want to read to you Psalm 42, verses 1 to 11. I'm hoping it's going to all be on the screen there for you. It is. As the deer pants for streams of water, So my soul pants for you, my God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When someone's writing poetry like that, the sons of Korah, as it turns out to be, sons of Korah, they say, I really am thirsting for God. I'm in a dry space, in a dry place. When can I go and meet with God? My tears have been my food day and night. Some of you are going to get this and go, oh, I know, they wrote that for me. My tears have been my food night and day. While people say to me all day long, where is your God? If you believe in this God, you're down the pitch, where is your God? Well, these things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I used to go to the house of God under the protection of the Mighty One with shouts of joy and praise among the festive throng. Oh, why, my soul, are you downcast? Why are you so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God. He's giving his soul a good talking to. He's got the questions. He already knows the answers. Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. My soul is downcast within me. Therefore, I remember you from the land of the Jordan, the heights of Hermon, from Mount Mizar, over the page. Deep calls to deep. You're waiting for it. In the roar of your waterfalls, all your waves and breakers have swept over me. By day the Lord directs his love, at night his song is with me. A prayer to the God of my life, I say to God my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by the enemy? My bones. It's not just something emotional and mental here, not just the thought life. It comes and it assaults me in my bones. It's got my bones here. By day the Lord breaks his love. At night his song is with me. A prayer to God of my life. I say to God my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I go about mourning oppressed by the enemy? My bones suffer mortal agony as my foes taunt me, saying to me all day long, where is your God? Why, my soul, are you downcast? Give me soul a talking to. Why are you so disturbed within me? Here's the answer. He gives the answer. He knows the answer. Put your hope in God, or I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. Well, the bloggers go, you know, the songs are using it wrong. And I'm going to show you tonight that the songs that we sing are using it right. In your Bible, you'll find that this psalm is attributed to the sons of Korah, and it is said to be a lament of a temple singer. So, if you think like this, tonight we have three temple singers up here. One of these temple singers has been banned from the house of God and sent to a far off place, and then therefore lamenting because this temple singer wants to sing, but for some reason they've been sent afar. They're far away from this place, and so this temple singer, they're downcast. They're disturbed in their spirit, and they find because of these circumstances now they have to navigate the emotionally troubled waters of life. And it is from the depths of these emotionally troubled waters of life that the psalmist calls out to God for the depths of his mercy. And so who is to say why this temple singer finds himself or herself exiled from the house of God? Who is to say what circumstances, and somebody will relate to this right here tonight, what circumstances cause any of us to find ourselves in emotionally troubled waters and a little bit adrift from the faith community? Who is to say? Well, I want to talk about Jonah. Of course, you know why he found himself a little bit adrift from the faith community and why he was a little downcast. The account of Jonah is an interesting account of a man who heard the call of God, and I find people who hear the call of God. Some of you talk to me about the call of God that you've heard, and then you never do anything about it. Well, Jonah heard the call of God to go to Nineveh, and you know what he did? He should have gone down and purchased a ticket on the train to Nineveh. He went down to the shop and purchased a ticket going in exactly the opposite direction, to the west, presumably to Spain. He got on board the ship, and you know the story. By the way, just think about that. I wonder how many people do that. They put their money into stuff that will take them away from the church, from God's mission, to the opposite direction to something that totally isn't God's mission. Yeah? See, I lead a church, so I know that people do that. Often put their money into stuff that will take them away from church rather than take them to church. And that's Jonah, and he's on board the ship, and of course, long story short, the ship that Jonah boarded ran into a storm, and the sailors find out that he's probably the cause of the storm, at least that's what they think, and so they throw him overboard. And immediately that Jonah is jettisoned as the cargo from the ship, the sea grew calm. And a huge fish came and swallowed Jonah. And that seems like such a sad story. But from inside the fish in the depths of the sea, in the deep, if you will, Jonah prayed to God. Here's the prayer. Jonah chapter 2, verses 3 to 6. You hurled me into the depths, deep, into the very heart of the seas, and the current swirled about me. All your waves, your breakers, swept over me. It sounds pretty much like Psalm 42, verse 7 to me. And I said, I've been banished from your sight, yet I will look again towards your holy temple. The engulfing waters threatened me. The deep surrounded me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. That'll do it for you inside the belly of the fish. Seaweed wrapped around your head. To the roots of the mountains, I sank down. The earth beneath barred me in forever. But you, Lord my God, brought my life up from the pit. So the picture you've got there is that from the depths of the sea, inside the belly of this huge fish, Jonah cried out to God for the depths of his mercy and received it. Right? Back to the psalm, Psalm 42. Whether this psalm is the personal experience of the author, or whether it was written as a pattern for God's people, that would be for you tonight, for all of us who will go through sometimes dry times, and if you're kidding me that you never do go through the dry times, well, perhaps you need an honesty check. If you kid me that you never go through downcast and disturbed times, maybe an honesty check. Times of navigating troubled waters, well, you need to know, if that's you, and it is all of us from time to time, that no matter how deep are those dry times, no matter how downcast and disturbed times are, no matter how deep they are, those times of navigating troubled waters, the love and the grace and the mercy of God is deeper. That's what I want you to take home tonight. And so this psalm and this expression, deep cries out to deep, is encouragement for you tonight, whoever you are, to cry out to God no matter how deep your situation has taken you. I don't know if you've ever heard of a preacher by the name of Watchman Nee, a Chinese preacher of the early 20th century. Great preacher, great. I've got loads of his books. Chinese man, and he worked in China. And I've got his interpretation of this psalm. And he interpreted this psalm and the application of this psalm that the deepness of God's love and mercy and grace is deeper than your deepest trouble, your deepest disturbance, and your deepest anxiety. Yeah. I'm going with Watchman Nee tonight. I don't know if you've heard of the famous English Baptist preacher of the 1800s, Charles Haddon Spurgeon. He takes this line of interpretation and application from this psalm, that the deepness of God's love and grace and mercy is deeper than your deepest times of trouble, disturbance, anxiety, or depression. So I'm going to say to the negative bloggers, do you want to sort of drown in the deepest sea? And so right there, if you read any of those negative bloggers, just ignore them, move on to something else. It's going to build you up rather than tear you down. God lifted Jonah from the deep when he called from the deep. And God lifted the psalmist from the deep, the writer of Psalm 42, when he called out from the deep. And God will lift you from the deepness of wherever you find yourself tonight or any other time. He will lift you from that when you call out to him from the deep, call out to him for the deepness of his grace and love and mercy. He's going to lift you up. And sometimes, here's the thing, here's what I've noticed. Sometimes we will not begin to cry out to God for the deepness of his grace and mercy and love until we find ourselves in that deep place. Because we think you're going to do it all by yourself. But when you find yourself in the deep place, that's when you're going to call out to God for the deepness of his love and grace and mercy. Thirsting for God in dry times, Psalm 42, verse 1, talks about longing for the refreshing spiritual water as the deer pants and so on. Psalm 42, verses 2 and 4, talks about longing for the house of God. Longing for that next slide. Longing for the house of God. I long for the house of God. This would be the house of God. Not the building, us, the people. Yeah. I go away for a while, I think I want to get back to the house of God. I don't want to stay away. I just want to get back to the house of God. My IT man posted a brilliant little post last night. I sent to a whole lot of you. Unfortunately, today I deleted it, but he said that's a good thing because he can post it again now. It'll come to you afresh. It's about a guy that wakes up looking all sad and disgruntled and unruly, and then he sees a better way, and that's to be in the house of God called Spires Life Church, and a beautiful picture of us worshipping right here. That's where I want to be. That's where I want to be with God's people. So remembering the fulfillment of joy and praise and festivity in the house of God. Yeah. I want that to stay with you. And I think this morning, 35 kids in Kids Church this morning, and I think about that, and I think how good that is, because I want those 35 kids in Kids Church to remember the joy and the festivity of being in the house of the Lord, so that later on, and a bit older, and they go through some tough times, they go, I remember the joy and the festivity of being present in the house of God. But that was then. And sometimes because of our own foolishness, and sometimes because of the foolishness of those around us, we find ourselves downcast and disturbed. And so we'll ask the question that the psalmist asks in Psalm 42 and verse 5. He gives his soul a talking to. Oh, why, my soul, are you downcast? Why are you like this? Give yourself a good talking. Sometimes some of you need to give yourself a talking to. Address your soul. Say, soul, why are you downcast? Soul, why are you so disturbed within me? And then tell up the way ahead. This is you talking to your soul. Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Saviour and my God. So he has the questions, but he has the answers. And often we already have the answers. We just need to be reminded of the answers. He gives your soul a good talking to, but just like us who also have the answers, he will ask the questions again. And as if he ought to say, you know, I asked that question of my soul before, and I gave my soul the answer, but here I am back here again. I need to ask that question. Why are you downcast? Now, Psalm 42 verse 6, my soul is downcast within me. Therefore, I remember you from the land of Jordan, the heights of Hermon, from Mount Mizar. He had the question, he has the answers. He does it again in verse 11, Psalm 42, verse 11. He continues with the theme of the being downcast. Why so disturbed? But you're hoping God got the answers, got the question. And he uses the imagery of the roaring waterfall of the Jordan River, where it rises in Mount Hermon, following the spring rain and following the melting snow from the highlands. And suddenly, there becomes a raging torrent, the Jordan River, coming down steep waterfalls, and you hear the noise of the water upon the rocks as it crashes down. And that just reminds me, he says, of the disturbance within me, and the noise in my soul, and the crashing water, and the depths of it all. And he says it's much also like the waves, and being dashed by the waves. Psalm 42, verses 9 and 10, I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by the enemy? My bones! I've got to tell you, before we're done tonight, I hope you have your communion on the way in, because in a while we're going to do communion. We're going to finish this service tonight. I'm going to call people forward to healing. You see, because this is what goes on. Our soul gets out of whack. God never gave us diseases. God never put bad stuff on you. God is the author of good. Sin in the world causes sickness and disease, but God never gave you that. God wants to lift you above that from the deep. So at the end of the service tonight, I'm going to call people forward, because you see, it starts with your soul being disturbed, yeah? And then it moves to your emotions being unsettled. And then it will move to physical things like my bones suffer mortal agony as my foes taunt me, saying all day long, where is your God? And some of you go, you know, I've got bad knees. I've got bad elbows. I've got bad this, bad that. Why did God do this to me? Well, he didn't. He didn't. He's got the answers for you. And part of the answer is found in Jesus dying on the cross for you, and you release that in your body when you partake of communion. You release that in your body when you allow people to pray over you, because they're going to claim the victory on your behalf that Jesus already won for you over these things. So, coming back to this guy, though, you think about it, whoever he might be. I say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by the enemy? My bones suffer mortal agony. It's the kind of guy that you'd never want to say, good morning, how you doing? Because he will tell you. So you say, good morning, you're looking good. And then you could argue against that. You know. This guy's down, isn't he? He is way down. He is low. How low can Joe go? He's down, dooby-doo, down, down, down. He's as low as a man can go. So how will you navigate the troubled waters? The roar of the waterfall, Psalm 42, verse 7, the next slide. The roar of the water. Deep calls to deep in the roar of your waterfalls. This is what I think is going on here. He hears the waterfall. He said, that's like all the disturbance inside myself. But hey, it's making a noise. And I think from the depths of the sound of the waterfall and the waves and the breakers that's sweeping over me, that's the prayer I'm going to send out to God because I don't know how to pray for this. Whatever noise is going on around you, use the noise as a prayer to God. So there's activity going on in the depths of my soul that's brought me down so low, but I know the depths of your grace and mercy and love, and I'm going to send the prayer using the noise of the waterfall, the noise of the traffic, the noise of the kids, whatever it might be. I'm going to send it up to you, Lord. Deep cries out to deep. God will answer your prayer. Psalm 42, verse 10. The waves and the breakers sweeping up. My bones are in agony. Psalm 42, verse 10. My bones suffer mortal agony. We're going to go for healing tonight. And what I find in the cry of Jonah from the deep and from the cry of the psalmist, chapter 42, also from the deep, and from a place of anguish, a place of disturbance, a place of depression being downcast, the focus of the cry from the deep is an appeal and a prayer to the very heart of God for his deep mercy, grace, and love. And the result, here's the result, is a deliverance from the deep place to a place of freedom. And some folk here need deliverance. You let it come over you and you go, well, these waters are too deep. Cry out from the deep to the deepness of God. Psalm 42 verse 7, deep calls out to deep. Psalm 42 verse 8, by day the Lord directs his love. So what about at night? Well, at night his song is with me, a prayer to God for my life. Psalm 42 verse 11, put your hope in God, and I will yet praise him, my Savior, my God. Psalm 42, verse 4, I pour out my soul to God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior, my God. Jonah chapter 2 and verse 10 in your NLT, following Jonah's cry to God from the depths, in the belly of the fish, from the depths of the ocean, crying out to God for his mercy and grace, it says this, then the Lord ordered the fish. I was looking for one that didn't say vomit. The translation. I go that one. That's nasty in night church. So the NLT. Then the Lord ordered the fish to spit Jonah out onto the beach. The psalmist, like Jonah, in response to his own prayer from the deep, the deep mercy and grace of God, by faith finds himself back in the house of God. Where would we all need to be? Psalm 42 verse 4. Walking among the crowd of worshippers, leading a great procession to the house of God, singing for joy and giving thanks amid the sound of a great... celebration. You're going to say celebration, God, kind of say it like that. Jonah also responds to his own prayer, finds his response from the deep to the deep, mercy and grace of God, by faith finds himself back on dry land because the huge fish spat him out, and now he can go and follow his God-given mission. Another story there, but I didn't do that tonight. Leslie Allen, a commentator, I just love this, commenting on Jonah's deliverance in response to his call to the deep mercy and grace of God and love of God, from the deep place in which he found himself, Leslie Allen writes this, Yahweh speaks to the fish. Whatever fish has got you in his belly, in your depressed state, you need to cry out from the deep to God, and Yahweh will speak to fish. Yahweh speaks to the fish, his instrument of salvation for Jonah. Who would have thought that the dark, depressed state in which you found yourself would be an instrument of salvation for you and deliverance? Who would have thought that? It's the very dark place that God's going to use. It obediently, this is the great fish, and doubtless gladly spews up this indigestible object, Jonah, and swims off with a flick of its tail its distinguished mission accomplished. You find yourself in a dark place. I'm not in a good place. I'm in a dark place. I'm down, down, zoom, zoom, down, down. Call out to Yahweh from the deep place. And the fish that's got you, we call it black dog sometimes, he's got it with a flick of its tail, it's going to swim away and spew you out where you need to be. Who would have thought? I don't know where you are tonight. Some of you actually do, but most of you don't. I don't know if you find yourself or have found yourself ever in the depths, but from the depths you can and need to cry out to God. You just need to do that. God loves you so much. Never lose sight of the fact that He loves you so much. He has such a depth of love and grace and mercy for you. The deep place could be that very place, that very vehicle of God's deliverance for you. In the beginning. In the very beginning. Go right back to the beginning of your Bible. I'd like to have some of the Bible here this morning. No, of course. They want to make a commitment to Christ. They go to the Bible. Yeah? Isn't that cool? Right back at the beginning of your Bible, Genesis chapter 1, verse 2 in your NLT, when the earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the, what kind of waters? Deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. No matter how dark and deep are the waters in which you find yourselves, you need to know this. Jesus Christ went through the deepest darkness of suffering on the cross for you, number one. Number two, the Holy Spirit is still hovering on your behalf over those deep, dark waters that you find yourself in order to bring you light and release, because in the very first place, God said, let there be light, and there was. So tonight, take hold of your communion. As we celebrate communion, I want you to take the first layer off there and find the bread. As you put this bread in your mouth and begin to chew it, this represents the very body of Christ. The very bread. And this is as though Jesus calls it the bread of healing. Some of you here tonight, you're struggling with physical stuff going on, and maybe it just started because of your soul stuff and your emotional stuff. He himself, 1 Peter 2:24, bore our sins in his body on the cross that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. Let's eat the bread of healing. Let's eat it tonight. Take the next layer off, get down to the cup, want to drink from the cup. Cup signifies the shed blood of Christ, shed on the cross. It's called the blood of the new covenant. He's broken a deal, a heavenly deal, by shedding his blood. He paid the ultimate price, that we might enter into a right relationship with God, that we might live like him. And I need to tell you that Jesus Christ is suffering no physical disabilities. He's not suffering any illness, and he's not suffering any emotional disturbance, and he wants us to live like him. Let's drink this. It's like drinking the very lifeblood of Jesus. Let's drink it together. I just want to read you something before we sing together, and then I'm going to make some comments about coming forward for those of you who need healing tonight. But this is the house of God. It's also the house of healing. And you've just eaten the bread of healing and drunken from the cup of healing. Here's the words from this song. Before the earth knew its foundations, you spoke the dust into creation. until the end when all has withered, then still your will endure forever. The lamp unto my feet, the light unto my path, your word will not be shaken. Your word will never fail me, like a fire in my bones, like a whisper to my soul. Your word is revelation. Deep calls to deep within your presence. When I hear you speak, my soul awakens. Your spirit leads my heart to worship as your word reveals the light of Jesus. Let there be light. Father in heaven, as we sing our song momentarily and as we look to press into you for wellness and well-being and health and healing, thank you, Holy Spirit. You hovered over those deep waters way back at the beginning and still hovering here over deep waters in which we may find ourselves. And Lord God, you're the one that just said the word, let there be light, and there was. Let there be healing, and there was. Tonight you want to speak that word to a number of people right in this gathering. They'll hear your word. Light will come. Healing will come. Health and well-being. We look to you, our Father God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand, church. Let's stand as we sing our song. Those of you who need healing tonight, don't put it off. Don't think, ooh, they think I'm the lame leper here. Don't think like that. It could be, that could be you. Doesn't really matter, because you're coming forward for healing. You're stepping into what deep is crying out to deep for you tonight. Let's sing together. Deep cries out to deep. That's what we're going to do right here, people. I'm going to ask some people to come forward and just lay hands on as many people as they can. Pastor Lee, Catherine, Lara, Graham, Sonia, Claudia, just lay hands on these people. Would you do that? And as many as you can get there, that'd be fantastic, Claudia. And I'm going to pray. Deep cries out to deep. Make this the cry of your heart tonight. Whatever it is that's been troubling you in your body, in your soul, in any part of your life, from the depths of where you are. God, to the depths of God's love and grace and mercy is so much deeper. Father, thank you for these people. I love each one of them with passion. You created each one. You know how we tick. You know the things that bring us down. But praise God, you know the things that lift us up. Deep cries out to deep tonight. Holy Spirit, you're hovering over the deep, dark waters in the very beginning. You're still hovering over those deep, dark waters that often surround us. Whether it's stuff that's confronting us that we've brought on ourselves, or whether it's stuff that confronts us because of others around us. You know the answers, Father. But I'm praying for healing over everyone here in this group tonight. You brought a company of people forward, Father, tonight. They're pressing into you to receive from you. And I'm praying that they're going to walk out of here tonight with more of a spring in their step than they had when they came in. But in the depths of their soul, because deep has cried out to deep, they'll know that you're at work in their lives, Father. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that you bore our sins in your body on the cross, that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By your wounds we find healing. Thank you, Father. Pour out your grace here tonight on all of these people in Jesus' wonderful, strong, and powerful name. And everybody said, amen, amen, amen. Deep cries out to deep. That's a wonderful thing. Keep on doing it. Deep cries out to deep. Would you do that in Jesus' name? A little bit of music from the sound desk. People, cafe's open. Information central is open. Keep on praying. From the depths of your soul, from the deep place you find yourself in, cry out to Jesus for the depths of his mercy, grace, and love. God is so good. God is so good. Be blessed, people. Have a fantastic week. If you haven't signed up for a Connect group yet, see them at Information Central. They will sign you up in a heartbeat, and they'll make sure you get all the right information that you need in Jesus' name. Be blessed.